بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ولي الصالحين وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My dear brothers and sisters, Qadar, divine will and predestination. People are confused about Qadar. They say that we don't understand. The mind, the rationale, the reason gets put about revelation, about the text of the Quran and the Sunnah, about the understanding of the Prophet ﷺ when he spoke about these things. And people, of course, they're not going to change the text, but they're going to try to change the interpretation. No, that's not what the Prophet ﷺ meant. Why though do we have a problem when it comes to Qadar? Let's start with the problem first, and then we're going to go to the solution. So what's the problem and how did we reach to a confusion of Qadar? First and foremost, we have a problem because the Muslim Ummah, as it moved through history, it encountered different philosophies and different people as it moved, as it expanded. The Greeks, the Westerners, different philosophies, Jewish, Christian, of people who question some aspects of the Quran and the Sunnah. What does this mean? What do you mean that Allah created everything 50,000 years or he knew or he ordered the pen to write everything 50,000 years before everything was created? What do you mean this? What do you mean that? What if you choose this and that doesn't happen? All kinds of what if has caused even some of the Muslim scholars to think of things that they're not supposed to think of. Okay? To dwell into certain aspects and write books to respond. They felt upon themselves to respond to these philosophers, to explain to them what it is so that they can defend. Their niyyah was to defend the lay Muslims, the masses who were getting confused. Some of these debates and some of these talks were public. Some of these things were being pushed. Some of the, depending on which part of the world the Muslim empire was, the religions would have debate and people would convert to Islam or convert out of Islam and so on. So the problem is that we were influenced, we were made to doubt the fundamentals of some of these principles, specifically where it comes to Qadr. And we know that Qadr, وَقَدْرِ خَيْرِهِ وَشَرِهِ مِنَ اللَّهِ, this is one of the pillars of Iman. Okay? The Qadr, the good and the bad, whatever happens, this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So people get confused. Why? Because of the questioning of those who are questioning. The non-Muslims, the philosophers. What do you mean? What does that mean? Are you sure you're convinced about that? So the Muslim goes, oh, wait a second. Ooh, yeah, I didn't understand that properly. So now the mind is working above the revelation. First and foremost, the basic principle that we need to go back to is to understand where does Qadr fit? Where is it? What are the parameters? The most important parameter is not with Qadr, it's with us, human beings. Our minds are limited. It's the same with understanding all the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Oh, we're not supposed to understand God? Or you're talking like the Trinity? One, two, three, but one? No. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about the unseen, al-ghayb, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you certain things about himself. And you start asking, how? Okay? And that's why some scholars developed the concept, bila kayf, without how. It's not because they, oh, we're this thing and we're that thing. No, it's because you cannot reach that understanding because you cannot see it. It makes totally sense, right? But see, the so-called rational proponents of these things are saying, well, it doesn't make sense. It does make sense because if you cannot see something, how are you going to be able to fully 100% grasp it? You can only grasp it based on what is being given to you, right? But you understand that this to fit, and I believe in it because there's other evidence within the dunya, within the reachable and seeable that convinces me. Therefore, by default, of course, I will believe in the unseen. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيَتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. نعم الآية سورة البقرة. So, الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ, you have to believe in al-ghayb, right? So, let us understand, just let's make it very simple. Us lay people, you don't have to, there's so many books you can read about Aqeeda, about Qadr, about the sifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And yes, some student of knowledge, people who are doing this, they're dedicating their life, they do that. Like a doctor dedicates his life to medicine, to serve humanity. A sheikh, an imam, dedicates his life to serve humanity as well, to guide him to the right path of the Quran and Sunnah. But how about us, lay people? How do we understand? How do we deal with the confusion that some of these philosophers and intellectuals are trying to bring? We're moving around, living in the West, mixing with all kinds of religions and all kinds of philosophies. And here we are confused. Our children are growing confused because they feel somehow they're inferior. We're not philosophically strong enough. And of course, there's a reaction that happens to this inferiority complex, that Muslims now are delving more and more into philosophy. What is wrong with that, you would say? Well, at just face value, it looks good because it seems like we're in line with the intellectuals of the world, with Socrates and Aristotle and Democritus and you know, Descartes and all these, Nietzsche, right? Wow, these are the people that laid the foundation of psychology and philosophy and identity of the culture's development. Hence, Western society is much more superior than our Muslim societies, right? But that is a post-colonial trauma and actually post-colonial disorder. You know, we've been made to think that, but that is not correct. So the Muslims are engaging into that. They're building their centers, their education institutions based on philosophy. And of course, we champion our own philosophers down into history. I'm not saying anything, I'm not criticizing. They've had their, alhamdulillah, their great contributions. I'm talking about the principles of diminishing the revelation, the naql, you know, the text, the nusus of, you know, of Islam, and putting the aql above it, right? Because the philosophy is nice because you can interpret, you can look at different opinions. This can be interpreted this way. This philosopher said that, and because he's stamped as a Muslim philosopher, khalas, halal yani, right? No, that's not how it works. With all due respect, I'm not worthy of shining some of the shoes of these people, but it's about the principle. The other day I was looking at a post and someone was trying to justify a bad joke that they've made. And they said, well, you know, Ibn Jawzi was making jokes like that. And right away my response would be, with all due respect, because we love Ibn Jawzi. Like, if he were to do something that might not be correct, is that a possibility? Yes, that he did do that, I'm not saying that. But do we just say, well, Ibn so-and-so did it, and scholar so-and-so did that, and he said that, therefore it's stamped as halal? No, that's not the right approach. You cannot justify something or be on the back of a certain scholar. That does not mean that we don't follow scholars. Allah makes that as a principle. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلِ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَتَعْلَمُونَ. This is a principle that you ask the people of knowledge. If you do not know, this is part of the Sharia. But we do not follow blindly, just, oh, let me see where I can find my opinion. Okay, this scholar said this, it fits my philosophy. I can navigate and play a little bit with the understanding to fit my schema of thinking, as opposed to me changing my way of thinking to fit the Quran Sunnah. We're kind of having the wrong direction, the wrong, you know, sense. We should be changing, not changing the Quran or the understanding of the Quran Sunnah. Also, yesterday I was listening to a lecture where the teacher was saying that we can change the interpretation. We cannot change the text itself, but we can change the interpretation. And they were equating that to ijtihad that is correct, right? Because the doors of ijtihad are open. We are dealing with so many different issues in the 21st century. But you see, it's all confused. You're mixing and matching things that are not in the right place. So this is how we have reached here. The Muslims are very happy with having philosophical institutions, debates, being able to kind of put their minds over an interpretation. Even if I have a doubt about something, I'm not clear on something, I'm just gonna find my way and I'm gonna be satisfied that yes, there's always a way out. And that's not the best approach. All right, that's how we reached here. Is that the correct state? No. I believe it's causing more confusion. I believe it's causing people to change Islam. I believe it's causing people, in the end, in the short term, you might find tranquility and fulfillment. They say, okay, well, at least I know it, things are clear. But in the long term, you'll find someone else who's gonna question you more and more, and you're gonna get confused. So for those who really wanna get a bit more in depth, not fully at the scholarly level, I'm talking about just as a, not even a student of knowledge, just as a lay person just as a person who wants to read a bit more, has time, I recommend the book of Divine Will and Predestination, Shaykh Omar al Ashqar, Rahimahullah. Okay, he has 8 books in the Islamic Creed series. Okay, 8 books in the Islamic Creed series. And I totally, totally recommend this book. Okay, this is one of the greatest series of Aqeeda for someone who is a lay person and would like, almost like going to a student a little bit in the English language. It's a great, great, great book. But I want to quote from this book to kind of understand the important principles of Qadr, and I'm going to focus on specifically one of them, okay? Very simple. He says it's wajib to believe in Qadr, okay? Understanding the Qadr and its limits is defined by the Quran and the Sunnah. And point 3 is very, very important. We should avoid discussing Qadr in depth. Why? Because some aspects of it cannot be comprehended by the human mind. No matter how brilliant it may be, and others cannot be comprehended except with a great deal of difficulty, right? So we have to understand that yes, Qadr is important, and Qadr is something that is part of our belief system, but who and how and what are the limitations? Okay, one important thing that I want to also quote here, it says that it may be said, though, is this not a means of restricting the human intellect? It cannot, is it not something like where you're, okay, you're not allowed to think, and you know, people say in religion, right, you're not allowed to use your mind, you just follow. The answer is that it's not aimed at restricting human thought. No, it's not. But at protecting the human mind from wasting its energy on something at which it cannot excel. So that can engage in areas where he can or she can succeed. Islam presents, this is very important, pay attention. Islam presents man with the guidelines for believing in Qadr. The concept of Qadr is based, this is the most important, guys. This is where it clarifies everything and you understand everything, you put everything in perspective. The concept of Qadr is based on the fact that Allah knew everything that would be. And He wrote it. Okay, He ordered pen to write it. Willed it, meaning He created our actions. He had the will, and then He created it. You understand? As the Quran says, even our actions were created. So Allah, let's, you know, understand. This is easy for the human mind to understand these facts. There's nothing difficult, complex, or ambiguous about this. This is the simplest. If anything, out of this whole book, okay, this paragraph here is what makes it. This is the one that you can easily clarify everything. Again, number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew everything because He's Al-Aleem. He knows everything. Number two, because of this, He wrote it. Number three, willed it. Number four, created it. Simple. Brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Aleem. Do you understand? All the possibilities. You know, sometimes people say, what if I would have went this way? What if I would have went that way? What would have changed? How would have, what, I make dua that Allah knew. Dua changes qadr. This and that, I'm confused. No, simple. Allah knew all the possibilities, all the algorithms, all the everything. If I did this, this would happen. If I would have done that, this would happen. I would make dua. I would not make dua. I would be inspired to make dua. I would, every single possibility, lack of, or this or that, was known by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because He's Al-Aleem. Nothing escapes Him. When you understand, that's why we insist on Aqeedah. That's why we insist on understanding the Asma wa Sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why we insist that more people should preach who are qualified about Aqeedah while they're talking about something different. Because it's so important to know who you are worshiping. If people understand this one name, this one attribute of Allah, that He's Al-Aleem, the whole issue of Qada wa Qadar, the whole issue of divine and predestination, divine will, all these are clear, simple. Everything was known by Allah. Allah ordered everything to be written. Allah willed it. Allah created it. No one shares in this other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Barakallahu feekum. Again, I really, really recommend this series of books to everyone. This is one of the best, okay? Shaykh Omar al-Ashqar, rahimahullah, he died a few years ago. What a great contribution. 8 books, about angels, devils, about the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything. Barakallahu feekum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of you. If you have any comments, please post them. If you have any questions, let me know. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.